Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome to this week's weekly recap video. Before we jump into the questions from last week's videos, I just wanted to let you guys know that we will not be attending the Boise Flower and Garden Show. In fact, nobody will be. The event has been canceled, as has most all other events. I am bummed that I'm not going to be able to meet those of you who are planning on attending, but we are hoping that once everything passes and things settle down, we will be able to come up with some other meet and greets to make that happen. So anyway, let's just jump right into the videos from last week. The first one was a work day in my parents' garden. In that video, Aaron and I packed up the car with a bunch of tools. We brought Chris and Benjamin, and we just did a bunch of work in my parents' garden. It was a really fun, kind of festive feeling day. It's just good to get out of your own house, and it's good to get out of your own routine and do something for someone else. And it was a beautiful day. So Cole asked, what were the hedge plants where Scout the Kitty was? And it was right toward the end of the video. And they've got boxwoods that kind of line this pathway. And those are called Mount Bruno boxwoods. They're a type that stays, they're more narrow leaf, dark green, and they stay quite small. I think their max size is like 18 to 20 inches or so tall and wide. So even if you don't prune them, even if you leave them fluffy, they stay very small and round. Fifi says, how do your parents dispose of that huge pile of leaves and sticks? Also guess the window box plants you use are semi-cold hardy. So that huge pile in their pasture, they burn. So they'll just get a nice bit. That's what a lot of farmers and gardeners do around our area. I think it's probably similar in a lot of areas, but they just wait till it gets a certain size and burn it. And yeah, that's what they do. I also guess the window box plants, they are semi-cold hardy. Most of them are actually perennial. Let's see, I used heuchera and hellebores, which were the main part of that display. And the artemisia, I think all of them are a zone 5. The heuchera might even be a zone 4. The ranunculus are the only thing in that window box that wouldn't survive a winter. So even the vinca survives. In fact, I had that in my cold frame all winter. So they're all really great plants that you can utilize outside in the landscape, or those were outside, but you could utilize them in the landscape after you're done with them in the window box. Tony asked, you once post a picture of a spot in your parents' garden. I think the caption said something like a lesson in texture. Anyway, in the picture was a drift of tiny yellow flowers. Were they a type of ranunculus? They are. They're a double creeping buttercup, a ranunculus repens pennifloris, I believe. And I do remember that picture. You have a really good memory. That seems like it was a while ago, but in that picture, there was just so many beautiful textures. And most of all, I think most all the leaves were green in that picture, but everything looks so set apart because the textures were on point. But those are a beautiful, like late spring, early summer blooming ranunculus that I just adore. C. Booth says, the rakes you were using, what brand were they? Do you find that they work well for raking the grass as well as the garden beds? Yes. So both of those are from Fiskars. One is a shrub rake and one is a leaf rake. I don't know if there's specific names to those. I think it's shrub rake, and the shrub rake was the little one, and then the leaf rake, of course, was the big one, and I really like that shrub rake. I used to use the Bond collapsible rake, which I still have in our barn, but I don't find myself grabbing that very often. I like that little one because it's so flexible. It doesn't wreck any of my plants, and then the leaf rake is good for bigger areas. Cheryl said, in your parents' veggie raspberry area, do they use weed fabric under the straw that is on the pathway? No. So that straw creates its own sort of weed suppression. Even the first year, in fact, I asked my mom yesterday, I asked her, did it take a certain amount of gardening seasons to really create a strong, like thick mat of that straw so that weeds wouldn't come up through it? And she said it happens in the first season because you put a thick enough layer, once it gets water on it, it forms a really thick mat. And so stuff has a really hard time getting through it. They actually deal mostly with wheat sprouting from underneath. Like it comes from the straw. There might be a few little seeds left. And so they just pull those out and they come out really easily, but it happens rarely. And once that first kind of shift of seeds sprouts, then until you put a fresh layer down, you don't really deal with that issue. The great job, huge difference from start to finish. Can I ask if it is the right time now to prune roses? Yes, now is a great time to prune roses. I've been working on mine slowly through my garden as I make my way around. Wendy said, what are you using to record and create your videos? Do you hire someone to do this for you? So that is what Aaron is doing. That's why you don't see him in a lot of videos. He's behind the camera. Like he's behind the camera right now. And we use a menagerie of different types of cameras. We have a gear page on our website. If you go to gardenanswer.com/gear, you can see all the stuff that we use for videos. And like, I think for that video, we used a lot of GoPro footage. We just set up one of Aaron's GoPros, and the benefit of doing that is that the battery life is crazy long. So you can do really long projects like we were doing that day and capture a lot of it without having to swap batteries out a ton, which we would have had to swap a lot if we were using our Canon cameras. Okay, so moving right on to the next video, it was how I pinch and fertilize my sweet peas, plus I assembled some obelisks. Well, Aaron and I assembled obelisks for them to grow on. First off, with that video, so I did show you my sweet pea seedlings. I pinched them back and explained why we do that, and then showed you the fertilizer I was using. A couple things it showed in the very first version of the videos that I gave the sweet pea tops to the chickens, and they are toxic. I kind of, in the back of my mind, when we were doing that, we were in such a hurry to get this, like, to get to the next step, that I kind of thought, like, maybe I should double check on this. And we didn't. I set them in there. The chickens are smarter than I am because they didn't eat them. Thank goodness. I started reading comments the next morning and I'm like, oh no. So I just like sprung out of bed. I like didn't fix myself up at all and just ran outside and to check on the chickens to make sure that they were still like alive. And they were, thank God. So I removed the sweet peas. I went out and got them some kale because I felt so bad. I just pulled a bunch of kale out of the garden and gave them, like, sorry about that. So anyway, it's just a really good lesson to learn. We did re-edit the video and we uploaded it a second time. And I did a little disclaimer down below saying, hey, like, I'm not trying to hide the fact that I gave them sweet pea tops, but I think it's irresponsible of us to leave a video up like that. Because if a newbie or, you know, somebody who's not a researcher like myself watches that but doesn't read comments to see everybody's warnings, then I don't want them to make the same mistake I did. So anyway, that said, I still hope the video was helpful. And we pinch sweet peas so that they create more blooms. It makes the plant create side shoots instead of just growing up with one long stalk. Wherever you pinch it, like right above the leaves, it'll create two new branches with more flowers. So Laura said, I planted several different seeds and some whole trays of plants like lettuce and spinach, and they've done nothing, and others seem to grow, don't seem to grow much. It's been almost 4 weeks. When do I give up? If it's been 4 weeks and you haven't seen sprouts from those, I would start over. I would double check. One, are the seeds good? I'm assuming that you bought new packets of seed, in which case most of the time they're fresh and they're good. Some seeds lose a percentage of germination rate over a period of time. So if they're like super old seeds or if they haven't been stored properly, you may not get germination out of them. If they dry out at all between the time you get them wet the first time and before they germinate, what happens is that seed, once it gets wet, it swells. And then it'll open up kind of a point of germination. If it dries out too much, it'll shut and it'll close off that point of germination and you lose your seedling from that seed. So if it got too dried out, that could have happened. The other thing is some seeds need light in order to germinate, like I believe lettuce does. So if you buried the seed too deep and it's not getting light, then it won't germinate. So all of that information is usually on the back of the seed packet. You could also Google search that. So I would check into those things and then start over. Rose said, Laura, where did you buy your obelisk? Which I received a message, and I guess the proper pronunciation is obelisk. Is that right? Obelisk? Yeah, I will probably continue saying obelisk. My apologies.
I think it's obelisk.
Obelisk? Obelisk. Oh, that just sounds so awkward to me to say because I've been saying obelisk for so long.
I think it is correct though.
Yeah, I don't care. It's all right. I don't care. So those were from Gardener's Supply. And the reason why I went with their obelisks is because I tried to build them once. I have all of the pieces and parts still in the barn. It's not worth it to me on some projects. Like, I will spend the money to buy certain things when I just, like, because I'm not a detail person, and if it doesn't come together easily or quickly, like, I will abandon it. And Aaron and I, like, we work on a lot of projects really well together. Building, if it's not straightforward, we're so different with our approach, it can be a little bit testy, because Aaron is a researcher. He likes to have a plan, like a plan from start to finish to know what steps. And I'm just like, let's just start into this thing. I don't need anything. Like, I can see what an obelisk looks like. And so, you know, I can build it. Anyway, they came from Gardener's Supply. I just went off on like a huge tangent on that. Sorry. Sheila said, I'm wondering if it's possible to root the sweet pea cuttings that you pinched off. Yes, you can root those. Stick them in some water and root them. I didn't because I have absolutely no room in any of my areas for growing at all anymore. And that's why I don't separate my seedlings. I just thin them. I cut them, the extra ones, and thin them and get rid of them. Because I just don't have room under my grow lights. It's too cold yet to plant them out. So if you have room and you want to try it, absolutely go for it. Yeah. The 5X says, what happened to your vermicompost project? Does it still exist? It does not exist anymore. I did do it. It worked really well. I've done it several times before. It's just that for me, vermicompost, unless you have a huge operation, which there's a couple people in our area that have massive vermicompost, what was the word I just used? Vermicompost operations. And in fact, they like bag it and sell it. But when you're doing it in a little bin, it's just like, I couldn't even really create enough for all of my houseplants. So for me, it was a little impractical. I think it's great. It's great for like urban gardening and things like that, where you don't have quite as much stuff. I gave that vermicomposter to somebody who wanted to give it a try. So that's where it exists and it lives on. It's just not here. Allison said, do you worry about overwatering with the self-watering containers and also watering with fertilizer? So the seed saving kits that I showed from Gardener Supply in that video have a self-watering reservoir beneath them. And it works really well. I will tell you that I do keep a close eye on the saturation level, because if they do sit on that mat and don't ever have a chance to dry out, I think that that's a bad thing for your seedlings. So what I do is I pick up the seedling tray and just kind of bump it up onto the top and like put it kitty corner a little bit, so it's up off the water for a day or two. But for me, I will do that because I hardly ever have to water them. It's so awesome. I just keep that reservoir full. When it looks like the soil's a little bit dry, I'll just pop them right back on top of that mat and they soak up the water. And most plants do better from underneath watering anyway. You can't do anything that's like totally hands-off. So either if you're doing a traditional type of seed tray where you're misting or you're doing a self-watering, you still have to watch things and monitor all those levels. Terry said the link for the start that takes you to Espoma doesn't have start. If we can't find the start, then what else can we use? And I kind of kick myself because start, I believe that they're not making the start anymore. I just had a couple of things left, so I was just using through them. What I would use is the grow fertilizer. It's the liquid grow, and you could use that as like a half strength when they're little babies, little baby seedlings, and then you could up the strength once they get a little bit older. Sorry about that. I should have checked on that. Whitney said, thank you for the reminder to tend to my seedlings. I'm growing nasturtium and lavender from seed for the first time. Should you pinch back all flowering seedlings or only specific ones? Only specific ones. You do not have to pinch back either nasturtiums or lavender. Just leave them alone, let them do their thing. You can Google that. I find there's a few websites that are so helpful. Florette Flower is a really good resource in terms of, she'll tell you like if it's essential or not necessary to pinch something back. Johnny's Seeds has really good information on their website as well. And then you could probably just Google it in general and find out the information based on what you're growing. Next was, how are the ones in your water jugs doing? I planted 2 jugs worth shortly after you did, and I'm just starting to see some new growth. They're doing really good. You know, there's a couple, no, was there just one I haven't seen growth on? My milkweed. I have the hardest time growing milkweed. I've tried, last year it was my own fault. I let them dry out. This year, they're not coming up in the milk jug. So I don't know if maybe they need a longer cold period. I'll probably just buy the plants on that. Honestly, for me, the water jugs, we'll see how it goes. I mean, they're all growing and doing great. I don't know what my opinion is on that yet, because I have to water mine an awful lot because we don't get enough rainfall or snow or any of that to keep them really saturated. So I have to check on mine every day. There's a few of them that just like dry out. I use the same soil on all of them, and I'll have like these 3 that are just like constantly dry. So I water those, and it's kind of like I'm tending to seed trays up in my plant room anyway. And all of my stuff up there is doing so well and growing so beautifully. I'm like, I don't know. Jury's still out. We'll see how the experiment goes as we get further on in the season. Virginia said, do you have a gnat problem in your plant room? So I have a bunch of fly sticks up there because I noticed a couple. I noticed a couple of those fungus gnats, and I thought, nope, this is not going to happen. So the best thing to do if you notice that is get yourself their revenge fly sticks. They're just sticky things that you put on a stick and put in your soil, it's like scattered about. And the fungus gnats are attracted to that and they get stuck on it and they die. Then you don't have to spray anything. And it really does if you like keep things in check. You could even do it like preventatively. And that's kind of like, it hadn't become a problem for me. And I just had noticed it was hopefully a one-off, but anyway, I'm glad that I've got that kind of thing in place up there. Okay, next video was I planted an over-the-top hookera planter. I got to use a couple of my new urns from Unique Stone. They're the Savannah urns that are so pretty. So pretty. And I had ordered bases to go underneath them and I completely messed it up. Like I did not get big enough bases, so I'm gonna use them as pillars somewhere else. But I'm so glad that it worked out that way because they're the perfect size urn, the perfect scale for where we put them. And then I ordered some hookeras to use in projects out in the landscape, but I thought, well, I just have them sitting here. Like, I'm not ready to put them in the landscape yet because I'm just not ready to do it. So I may as well just use them in a container for a little while, enjoy them, you know, out so they're not just like sitting in their can somewhere and having to water them all the time because they're in a smaller reservoir. Now that they're all kind of packed in there, they stay moist a lot longer anyway, and they're beautiful. So Pumpkin Becky said, I've always wondered what people mean by a season in gardening terms. Is it spring or more like a growing season? What's your interpretation? I think there are multiple interpretations. When I say a season, I mean the full year. I don't mean like spring, summer, or fall. If I want to talk about a specific season, I will address it by like if it's spring or summer or fall. But if I say like this plant is 2 seasons old, I mean 2 years old. That's my interpretation anyway. Carrie said, can you explain what it means when gardeners say blooming on old or new wood? I hope that makes sense. It absolutely does, and it's a very common question. So when a plant blooms on new wood, it means that it produces new wood during its growing season and it'll bloom on that new wood. Like, let me take hydrangeas as an example. It's a perfect example. So hydrangea paniculatas and arborescens, like limelights or Annabelle type hydrangeas, they produce blooms on new wood. So you can cut them back in the spring and they'll flush new growth and then they'll bloom on that new growth. The big leaf type hydrangeas or mountain hydrangeas, you know, like the pink and purple type hydrangeas, those bloom on old wood, which means that like this year, they already established their buds for this year's blooms on last year's wood. So if you prune them this time of year, you're most likely gonna cut off their blooms. So I hope that that makes sense. But like your lilacs and forsythias, you can't prune those in early spring because they bloom on old wood. So they already have their buds ready all winter long to bloom this spring. And so the best time to prune those types of things is immediately after they bloom, so they still have time to form buds that season for next year's bloom. Shelley said, how long does it take you to create an effect like the second urn filling with plants as Laura walks by? So I asked Aaron that question. He said it takes about 5 to 10 minutes, which surprised me because I love those kind of edits. It makes something like a video a little bit more dynamic and fun to me. And it looks like it would take a lot longer. I thought he was going to tell me like, oh, like 1 to 2 hours or something like that. So pretty quick. Anyone else enjoy seeing the leaves wave in slow-mo? So there was a leaf that went scattering across the concrete at one point of the video, and it looked like a mouse, but we slowed it way down, and I do believe it was a leaf. Jasmine says, I'm from the UK, and my hookera plants become snail snacks. Anyone have any advice? A bug and slug killer has worked really, really well for me. We don't have many, many snails, but we get a little bit, and we don't have many slugs either, but they do want to attack mostly our hostas, and we'll put that around the base of all the plants and it works really well. Bambi said, what is the difference between a hookera and a hookerella? So a hookera is a hookera, coral bells. Hookerella is a mix between a hookera and a tiarella. So it takes the best traits from both of those plants and mixes it together to make it be a hookerella. Tammy said, how do you determine the size or scale of pots? Is there some kind of rule or ratio? I have a deep front porch and struggle with placement and scale of pots. Any tips? Also, is it better to place pots on the porch or on the stairs? So I think the best thing to do is just to look around online for some inspiration. You can look up, you know, planters on porches, search a few keywords and see what other people have done and see what your eye is drawn to. There's so many different styles out there and different shapes of containers and that sort of thing that I think that's the best place to start and kind of create yourself like a idea board, so that you can have a vision of what you want to attain in the end. And you can use like a little bit of this and that, like a little bit of inspiration from this picture and a little bit from that one. It doesn't have to be a complete copy of somebody else's, but I think that's a really good place to start. You can place pots too on the porch or on the stairs or both. Like personally for me, I err on the no stuff on the stairs just because I used to do that. But I think I go through style changes too where I don't want the clutter all over stairs. Like I just want it clear and I want it to look like people can walk up and that sort of thing. So, you know, it just depends on your personal preference though. I mean, so just start searching around and start gathering ideas. Hello Condo said, what with the high heat you experience in your area, do you ever mulch your flower pots? No, because the plants become a mulch kind of themselves, like in no time at all. You can't see any of the soil. And we water very consistently because it is so hot. I mean, every pot on our property has to be watered at least once a day. So they stay saturated enough and cooled enough by that daily watering that mulch isn't necessary. Michelle said, I'm wondering where you got your containers and also what do you use on your gravel? You're able to roll things on it. So those containers were from Unique Stone, and then we used a gorilla cart to roll them around on the gravel. And we have several different types of gorilla carts. I like them because they have big wheels, and that's the key for moving stuff on gravel, because we do have some areas that are deeper and it's a lot harder to pull things through. But if you've got big tires on whatever cart you're using, it helps so much. Amy said, can I plant them on the north side of my house that never gets direct sun? I have no idea what to put on that side of my house. Previous homeowner has ferns and brunnera, which I like, but I need more plants as it's sparse. Absolutely. Heucherellas, heucheras, tiarellas are great for north sides of houses. You could also do a stilbe and hostas and lungwort, and you could do sweet woodruff and lamium. And I would amp up the fern amount because there's so many different ferns out there that are beautiful. What else? Ligularia is wonderful. I think if I can think of any other plants for you. Lots of really pretty shade annuals too that you can pop in for some color, some impatiens and begonias. Yeah, there are really a lot of different options. I would go to a local garden center, usually like in April, May, June, if you go even on like an every week or every 2 week basis, so you can see all the new stuff that they're bringing in, and go into their shade area, the area designated to shade plants, and you'll see all kinds of different things. Next video was we figured out an easier way to plant arborvitaes. So in that video, we took 74 North Pole arborvitaes to our church and planted them. Aaron used an auger, a 9-inch auger, to create the holes, which was amazing. And what it doesn't show in the video is that it was kind of a perfect, it took us, what do you think? Like 4 hours?
Yeah.
4 hours total to do that. And it was good for both of us because it looks like in the video that it was like, you know, we just like rolled through this and that we were just digging holes one right after the other. But what would happen is Aaron would aug the hole and then I would do my thing and plant it while he rested. And then we would move to the second one. He would aug the hole. I would do my thing. So we each had a little bit of a brief break in between each one of them. So it really didn't feel like a chore at all. And that auger was awesome. I know Aaron was sore. I was sore too. I mean, because it's a lot of work either way, but it would have been so much more work to have to dig those with a shovel. Jackson said, will they put landscaping fabric down to prevent weeds like you did under the arborvitaes? If so, would it go under or over the drip? So if they do decide to do that, they would put it underneath the drip so that the drip was accessible. If anything, you know, were to go wrong, they would be able to unearth it and fix it easily. But I don't know that they have a particular issue with any sort of weeds right in that area. They've been taking care of it for a very long time, so weeds haven't really had a chance to like become a problem in that spot. The only reason I use it under my arbs here and then underneath some boxwood areas is because I have bindweed really bad in certain areas. And if you let bindweed get out of control, like there's your toast. I mean, you'll be pulling it for the rest of your life because you can't spray that bindweed out of a hedge because it will kill your hedge. So anyway, there, I don't think it's a big deal. And I think it's better anyway. I try not to use it if I don't need to. Chantel said, these look fantastic. How much have yours grown in the last few years? It looks like a lot. Can you show us a side-by-side from the last 3 years? I think we could do that, right? We could show a side-by-side really quick on the screen. Yeah. When we planted them, I know that they were just right at that middle rung, middle, how come I can never think of the word?
Fence?
Rail. Fence rail. They were right at the middle one and now they're up over the top one. So they've grown a lot and they've really beefed out. Like they've gotten wider as well. I'm really happy with them. Zen of Plant says, is it possible to change out a few sprinklers to drip while leaving the rest of the sprinklers as sprinklers in the same zone? That's how our garden was when we moved in here, and it's not ideal. I wouldn't recommend doing that if you could at all possibly run drip from even a faucet. If you can set up a drip system with a timer hooked to a faucet nearby, I mean, you could even like lightly trench a piece of black poly underneath grass or whatever to get to the area you need to go to. I would recommend not putting your grass and your flower beds on the same zone, because we just went through getting ours all separated, because your grass and your flower beds do not need the same amount of water, and it can, like, the plant's health, they could suffer. One or the other, one of them can suffer from needing too much or not needing whatever. KJ said, what kind of DeWalt tool is that? We'll put a link down below. What's it called?
It's a 60 volt stud and joist drill.
60 volt stud and joist drill with a 9-inch
power planter
auger. Yep. Links down below. And how many batteries for all those holes? And I did fail to mention in the video that it took 1.5 batteries to make 74 holes, which is crazy. I mean, we weren't dealing with anything super heavy, although that auger, I mean, it would work through a lot of different types of soil. We weren't in like heavy clay or running into a lot of rocks. We ran into big pieces of asphalt in the last two holes, but we actually had to get a shovel to pry those out. But yeah, 1.5 batteries, pretty good. Enchanted Seasons Lawn Care said, what is the cheapest way to buy that many arborvitaes? Unfortunately, there's really not a super cheap way to buy a lot of things like that. I mean, you could find them probably in smaller sizes, but then you have to keep in mind that, you know, you're gonna take, it's gonna take years and years to get to your end result versus buying something that's older. And that's why, one, when you're buying a larger plant, you're buying years of growth. You're also buying advancement in breeding. So like with the North Pole Arborvita, they're improved from the older type of arbs that you could still get. But these resist winter burn. They don't die out. Like, you know, you used to see those lines of arbs and there'd be like one dead here, two dead here. So eventually you have to replace all of these, like, and so you have a random size hedge and you don't deal with that with North Poles like you will with the others. So you are investing in quality and it is more of an upfront investment, but in the end, it's so much better. There's also a couple other possibilities. I mean, if you're getting a lot of something, like I would say a bulk amount for something like that would be 50 or more, just dealing like garden center background. Like if somebody came in and asked for a discount for buying 10, I would probably say no. But if they're ordering, you know, 50, 75, 100 or something, sometimes a garden center will work out a deal with you. Also, end of season closeouts, but you're not guaranteed. You know, I mean, you can wait till the end of the season and pick up what you can, but you'll never be able to get them usually in that kind of quantity. Megan said, how was Aaron able to get the drone to follow the truck? Aaron was in the passenger seat operating the drone while I was driving. That's how we had it flying above us. So he was like doing all of that while I was doing the driving. When we had it like circle us, when we were planting, like, we were the only two people there working on the project, and Aaron would like set up the camera in different angles and stuff like that. But he had the drone set up on a specific route, and you can do that to where it'll like do exactly what you want it to do. So he had it fly around us a couple of times when we were working, which I thought was really cool. And then Sarah asked, how do you start from scratch making a layout or plan for a home garden? My husband and I just purchased arborvitaes for our own backyard because of your hedge as an inspiration. We are first-time homeowners and now dabbling in gardening. Where is the best place to start when making a plan for our backyard? So when I tackle a new area, and I am not a landscape designer, I never have been. I don't enjoy that part. I enjoy it on my own property, but it was one part of working at the garden center I did not like. I did not like designing people's landscapes at all. But what I would start with first is any hardscape. So you need to determine how you want to use your space, and it's good to live in it for a year to see, like, okay, do we want a patio here, or do we want a fire pit, or do we want a gazebo or whatever? You know, you can kind of determine like what areas you think you're going to use the most and where you need your hardscaping, where you want pathways and stuff like that, because those things, once they're in, it's very hard and costly to move those things. So you want to make a good decision from the beginning. And then you start in with your foundation plants, like your or your bone structure plants, I should say. So evergreens and trees. And I would invest in some good ones and maybe even put a little bit more money into buying bigger ones so that you can have shade a little bit quicker. Like Aaron and I, which I'll talk about in the next video with the new property, we are going to, Aaron yesterday, he's like, we should just blow our whole budget on trees. And he's kind of right because if you get trees started in the very beginning, you will thank yourself so much in even 5 years. You'll be like, I'm so thankful that I decided to plant the trees then, because they'll have put on so much growth. And it is a time investment when you're starting a garden like that. So evergreens and shade trees next. And then you start in with your bigger shrubs and you kind of just work your way down from there. You can put in your perennials after your shrubs and then your annuals. That's kind of like my checklist right there for what it's worth. Okay, so moving on to the very last video, which was titled We Bought Something New. And in that video, we finally got to announce that we were able to buy 3.6 acres that joins our property right out front. We had started the process of asking our neighbors about this land, seeing if they were interested in selling at some point over 2 years ago. It was right after Benjamin was born, and they were totally open to it and excited. And at first it was just gonna be 2 acres, and then they decided they were okay with us purchasing just kind of like the whole thing, which was awesome. And so I'm so thankful. I'm actually thankful for the timeline. I'm thankful to have it. I'm so excited. The timeline allowed us to really think through the purchase to save money so that we could do some things. And so we've been trying to be really diligent about that. And I think it's just going to open up so many opportunities for like different projects, because like it is an investment too in what we're doing. You know, our business is to create videos, to create inspiration for you guys. And like, I don't know, the more we have more space we have, the more different things we can do. Because I get to thinking like, how exciting is it going to be for people to watch me plant this one area every single year? Like maybe you guys like that, but I think I would get bored with that. Like, oh, okay, there's just, you know, there's that area again. I don't know. So this is just going to be so much fun. Laura said, why do you need to put up a huge fence line? The property boundaries seem pretty obvious, especially with a row of arbs. Just wondering. Couple of reasons for me. I like to have boundaries. I like to see the boundaries. That helps me in my planning. I like to have things look very precise. I guess that's kind of the formal garden coming out in me a little bit. Also, it's a privacy thing for us too. People occasionally find our house, they drive by, it drives me nuts. And so I think having part of it, we'll be able to gate part of it to create a closure on one side, which will help a ton. There was a question, I don't know if I grabbed it, but one of you guys asked if we'll be able to put a privacy gate in the front, and I wish we could. We can't, because it's not, like, even though our land is on both sides of the lane, it's not technically our lane, so we can't close it off, but we will be able to put a bigger privacy sign out front. And having a fence will help create that kind of, like, this is a private property sort of look. Amor said, would you ever consider getting any farm animals now that you have more land? Aaron's going, no, probably not for a while. I don't really plan on creating any of that as pasture or keeping any of it as pasture. I would like to get ducks one day. I grew up with ducks and I absolutely love them. I would love to do that. And then maybe one day, like a lot of years from now, we'll be able to buy another piece of land and put horses on it, Aaron. Catalina said, what will you do with so much more fruits and veggies that will come from this? I'm hoping to give them away. There were quite a number of questions about, like, are you going to become a cut flower farm? No plans on doing that. Are you going to have a farm stand? No. We're not going to create any sort of business that's, because this is our home, and we don't really want, like, they're all kind of private lanes around here, and I don't want to create a bunch of extra traffic for all of our neighbors. So we just plan on, like, I have no idea how it's going to go this year with the cut flower garden. Eventually, I would like to have an acre of that property sequestered off as the cut flower garden. It won't be in that spot this year, and it won't be a full acre this year. I'm not planning on that. I'm just gonna get my feet wet with the whole cut flower thing. And it's really just for our enjoyment here. I want friends and family to cut flowers. With any abundance, I would love to give it away. That's just kind of the thought for this year. Anisha said, are you guys also planning to sell cut flowers once the new garden is up and running? I kind of answered that. I'm not planning on it at this point. Who knows? You know, everything is subject to change, and like our minds change a lot, and we think of a new idea that we think is cool. And so you guys are going to probably see a lot of like kind of back and forth on what we end up doing with this space. The Bailey said, huckleberries. I wish we could grow huckleberries. They only grow on the mountains around here. It's too hot and dry. Leticia said, compost next to your neighbor's house. Totally hadn't considered that, and thank you guys for pointing it out. We will put the compost pile somewhere where it will not affect somebody else, because that would make me irritated if a neighbor like moved in next door and just like plunked a compost pile right by my backyard. That would be bad. So we will definitely be considering those things, and that's why like it's good. Many minds are a good thing, and just hearing your guys' opinions on that was really that was helpful. So I was like, oh yeah, I haven't really considered that. However, a good compost pile shouldn't smell. They don't have a smell unless something like some kind of balance is off, but it's still a risk, and I don't know that I would want to do that. I don't want to make our neighbors nervous. Elizabeth said, can anyone tell me about how many acres they already have before the addition? 2. So we'll have like 5.5, 5.6 in the end altogether. Next was maybe a golf cart. So we were driving a Gator, and it was a gas-powered Gator, and it was quite loud. We were just trying it out to see. That one has like all the bells and whistles, and they dropped it off for us to just trial. And we figured out very quickly that one, electric is probably the way to go, because we do have neighbors that, it drives me crazy when like four-wheelers and like loud side-by-sides and things like that, when people are running those all the time, I think it's very intrusive on somebody else's peace and privacy in their garden. So we want to try to minimize that. So electric, either an electric Gator or a golf cart or something like that is probably on the docket at some point. Shirley said, just wondering if your white fencing gets black mold spots all over, or is that an Ohio humidity problem? We don't have that issue. I mean, they get really dirty. I have to hose them down. And sometimes like a magic erase marker will take off any like scuffs or whatever, but it must be a humidity problem. We have no humidity, so we're good there. We're golden on that front.
We did get black spots under, I think, those are elm tree.
Did we?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Aaron said we got black spots under our elm tree. I don't remember that at all. Are they like, what was it?
Just black spots are hard to get off. You could scrub them off.
Really?
Yeah.
How do I not remember that?
I don't know, it bugged me.
Did it?
To no end, yeah. But then we got rid of all the elms.
I have no recollection of that. Wow. Okay, just a few more questions. Jana said, what about the dream greenhouse placed somewhere out there? The dream greenhouse, that's out a few years now that this land purchase. So, you know, we initially planned on buying 2 acres, so that's what we were saving for, and then it almost doubled. And so we were like, well, we're not going to do as much on the land this year, maybe next year, as we thought. Dream greenhouse, I would love to have at some point. I don't know when that will happen, but I was almost thinking, like, wouldn't it be cool to pick up our gazebo and have it moved, like, to the back part of the cut flower garden, and maybe have, like, backside and the sides covered with windows, and, like, make it kind of an open fronted shed over there, and have it like that can be a more rustic look apart from our house, and then maybe put a greenhouse where the gazebo is. Oh, sounds like a lot of work. We'll see. Vicky said, looking forward to seeing the new projects as they come out. Are you considering ever putting in a pool? No. My parents have a swimming pool, so I figure that's good enough. We can go out there and enjoy their pool when we want to. I mean, never say never on any of the stuff that I'm talking about. Like, never say never. But they are a lot of maintenance, as are ponds, in my experience. I know that there's probably better ways to put together ponds I just don't know about. So at this point, we're not planning on a pool or a pond out in that space, but you never, ever know. Eddie said, have you ever thought about underground utilities so you can get rid of the poles? Yes, I would absolutely adore that. If we could get rid of those three big poles in front of our house, it would be amazing. You know, when we moved in here, there were two poles on the interior of our property, and we did have that buried. And the gal that came out from the power company kind of gave us, we asked her about that big line in front of the house. And we asked her what it would cost. And at that point, she was like, oh, I don't know. You know, she kind of gave us this huge number. And we thought, so we kind of like put that out of our minds, like it couldn't be done. But I don't know, it might be something we readdress at some point, because honestly, having those three poles gone would improve the aesthetic look of the front of our house so much. I mean, 100% unnecessary, but it would look very pretty. Paula said, why is the cut flower garden not going to be closer to your house? And will you eventually have a small shed or barn structure? You know what? It's all subject to change. Like I said, like this year, the cut flower garden will be very close to the front of our house, just because we want the back corner to be open when we start in on work back there. But we initially thought that we would have some kind of a shop built in kind of the front right, like I'm looking out of our sun porch right at the property. And we were thinking of maybe doing a shop at one corner, but now we're kind of thinking maybe we won't. And that's why the flower garden was going to be moved back, because we wanted, as you go down the lane, we wanted to be able to see like across grass and flower beds, and then have our structure stuff kind of toward the backside, so it looked like this big sweeping spot, sweeping view. I don't know. Jan said, how many workers do you think you'll need when it gets all humming in the spring and daily maintenance? Chris is going to be a really busy boy, but he may even need a little help. And that might be a possibility at some point. I don't know. Right now, everything's so well in hand. This is like the best spring ever. Now that we have Chris's help, he's kept up on keeping things just maintained. And he's able to do, like, when we get an order of something in down at the garden center, he's able to go run for, you know, and get that so that we can keep video production going. And it's been such an enormous help and a huge blessing, because Aaron and I are able to actually, like, almost take weekends now, which is so great. We're able to hang out with Benjamin and not feel like okay, we gotta be doing work all of the time. And that's just not healthy. That is not a healthy way to live. So we are super thankful for Chris. I have no idea how it's gonna go with this new land. Like at this point, we're thinking of like maybe trying to see how we do it on our own, and then maybe looking for somebody part-time if we need to, and then maybe going from there. I don't know. And who knew that when we started making videos, it would turn into this sort of thing? It's just crazy. We feel enormously blessed, enormously thankful. It's so much fun, you guys. And that's it for this week's videos, this week's questions. Thank you all so much. Hope you have a really, really wonderful week, and we will see you in the next one. Bye.